good. All right, so that's that one. Gobbling my words there a bit. All right, okay. So we said King of Glory. Okay, good. Okay. Good. Okay, so this is the prayer part. Thank you, Lord. My friends, today, isn't it just amazing that he's our king? There's no other king like you, King Jesus. We worship you today. What a joy to surrender our lives to you, to live under your glorious kingship. Oh, we worship you, Lord. Even as you fill our gaze now, we pray that you would just remain firmly in our focus, Lord, as we continue forward now. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. And together we said, amen and amen. Wonderful. Once again, welcome to our online service. If you're new to our service, my name is Greg. Once again, a big welcome to you. Great to have you joining us today. A few announcements. So in this week, we finished our four-part devoted series. It was a midweek series. If you missed any of them, I'd encourage you to watch them. They're videos. They were short teaching videos. You can catch the full series either on Facebook or on our YouTube channel. All right, so have a look at those. And in the last one, the last part that Dwayne did, we looked at prayer. A vitally important topic, something that the early church devoted themselves to. And we have an opportunity to do that together on Tuesday night, 7 p.m. It's going to be our last corporate prayer meeting for 2020. So come and join us if you can for that vitally important time. And in water baptisms, also something so important on our Christian journey. If you have never been baptized in water, or if you are wondering and you have some questions about it, please get in touch with us. We are going to be having water baptisms after our service next Sunday, the 29th of November. So please get in touch with us. Just such an important, vitally important part of our Christian journey. All right, wonderful. So we are busy with our series on joy. And the way I understand it is that in medical school, the med students will first spend a few years studying the healthy human body before they move on to look at the ailments and sicknesses and things that can go wrong with the body and how to fix it. So today we're going to be looking at some of the things that can go wrong, but I need to be so clear on this. Nothing goes wrong with God's joy. Obviously, that's perfect. Problem's never on God's side. We're going to be looking at things that can impact, influence our experience of his joy. All right, so it'll become clearer as we go forward. So last Sunday, you could say we were really looking at the healthy body when it came to the joy of the Lord. And it's good to have some reminders about that healthy body. So let's go through a few recap points. So we've been saying through this series that joy is more important than we realize. It's more important than we think. And we looked at the importance of joy and relational attachment when it comes to our development, our growth as human beings. It's also so important. Joy and relational attachment are so important when it comes to spiritual formation, our growth and maturing in Christ, all right? And so last Sunday, we looked at the difference between joy and happiness. You might remember, if you're with us, I trust you do. Happiness depends on circumstances. We tend to be happy when things are going well, whereas joy isn't like that. We can experience God's joy even in difficult circumstances, even in circumstances where we wouldn't be happy, all right? Now, we saw from the scriptures that God is our true source of joy. And there were so many scriptures. We looked at a few. There are so many more that speak of God as being our true source of joy. But there was something very interesting that some of the older texts, the Hebrew texts, connect that joy with. Okay, so you might remember from last week, it was something of a surprise even to me as I was reading and looking into this, is that joy is connected with the face of God, the countenance of God. Now, many of you remember from last Sunday, many of the newer translations of the Bible will speak of joy in the presence of God. And that's not wrong. That's completely right, okay? But there is something amazing, friends, when we have this picture of the face of God turning towards us, a sparkle in God's eyes as he looks at us. God's face lighting up in delight, communicating his gladness to be with us. That's an incredible picture, and that causes joy to rise in our hearts as well. All right, so joy is a relational thing. You might remember this quote from Wilder and Hendricks. They said, this is the definition of joy. I want to be with you. Joy is relational in its essence. We experience and we receive joy primarily through our relationship with God and also in relationship with others around us. Okay, so in week one, we looked at this. We said that in recent times in particular, we've come to understand that God has designed our brains to run on joy, almost like a car runs on fuel. Our brains desire, they seek out joy, all right? And this is especially where relationships become so important. Last Sunday, I shared with you what the author said about God building facial recognition circuits into our brains that connect with our joy center. So we're kind of looking around us, looking for facial expressions and eyes that communicate this joy to us. So relationships are vitally important when it comes to joy. I was looking up a whole lot of joy scriptures. I just went through a concordance reading all scriptures on joy, and I came across this one. It's Proverbs 15, verse 30 in the New Living Translation. It says, "A cheerful look brings joy to the heart. Good news makes for good health." I really love that. A cheerful look brings joy to the heart. That's the very thing that we're talking about. The bottom line, friends, is that joy is really important. Our brains are seeking out joy around us. So now let's look at a potential problem, okay? What happens if our experience of God's joy is not as He intended? We are experiencing lower joy. We're finding ourselves quite isolated, withdrawn, kind of distanced, all right? And as we said, joy is running rather low. So would it be a thing of our brains just saying, okay, so there's not too much joy around me, no problem, I'll just carry on, okay? Obviously, that's not going to be the case. If you look at how God has designed our brains, that we are looking for joy. We are seeking it out. Okay, so writing about this kind of low joy experience, the authors say this, Wilde and Hendricks say, "Since joy helps us regulate painful emotions, when it runs low, we will look to non-relational sources to stop the pain. Soil that is low on joy is primed for growing addictions. When our brain looks for joy and does not find it, we become vulnerable to pseudo-joys. These are substances and experiences that trick our brain to temporarily shut off the unpleasant emotions, but they are non-relational and ultimately unsatisfying." Okay? So pseudo-joys then would be things that could closely resemble, maybe even deceptively resemble, God's true joy. But they are not substitutes for it. They can never take the place of God's true joy. All right? Our brains will still be seeking that joy. They won't be satisfied. Now, the authors give some examples of these pseudo-joys. They could be things like food, shopping, social media. I could add things like television, gaming, certain sports and hobbies, okay? Okay, so these things are not evil in themselves. There's nothing wrong, obviously, with food, shopping, etc. And we can derive some pleasure from them. So for instance, I like to say that I really enjoy my food. I like food. I get pleasure from eating food, especially if it's something that I've brought. Not so sure about shopping, all right? Lori tells me you can get pleasure from shopping. In my experience, if I go to the shops, I've got like 1, 2, 3, maybe 4 items, short little shopping list. I get there, everything's on special, and I can come home as soon as possible after this. That's one time I'm a little bit happy after shopping, but otherwise I'm not too sure about that. But be that as it may, the important point is that we can get some pleasure from these things, but they can never substitute or replace the true joy of the Lord. They can never satisfy us in this way. Now, these are pseudo-joys that aren't wrong in themselves, but there are others that definitely are more wrong and harmful. And yet we begin to look at addictions. When we are addicted to things, we crave things like sugar, alcohol, drugs, and pornography. Now, these addictions, obviously, it goes without saying, they are very harmful things. But again, we recognize that whilst they might try to trick our brains into thinking that we are being satisfied, we are not going to be satisfied. We are not being filled. The joy tank is not being filled when we chase after these pseudo joys. All right? And so it's a good thing, friends, to take stock today. And we'll probably come back to this right at the end as well. But just to ask yourself, am I chasing after some pseudo joys in my life right now? Am I craving some of these things? The thing is that we can try and justify them. You can say, well, they're just little pleasures. They're not so harmful. They're not so wrong. The problem, friends, is that it's a futile chase. It's a waste of time. We'll just spend more and more time going after these things, more and more time seeking after them, and find ourselves growing more and more frustrated whilst feeling more and more empty. I've been in that place in my life, all right? So beware of these pseudo joys when we try to replace God's joy to fill that space with these things, which they never can do, all right? Here's another great question to ask. Can we lose God's joy, all right? Can you lose it? Is it possible for the joy tank kind of to start going down, so to speak? Okay, we read words like these of Jesus in John chapter 15, verses 9 to 12. This is from the New Living Translation once again. I have loved you even as the Father has loved me. Remain in my love. When you obey my commandments, you remain in my love, just as I obey my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you these things so that you'll be filled with my joy. Yes, your joy will overflow. This is my commandment. Love each other in the same way I have loved you. There is no greater love than to lay down one's life for one's friends. So sandwiched in between this picture, remember, this is the true vine text, okay, where Jesus is speaking about remaining in him, remaining in his love, the importance of obedience. Here he says, he speaks on joy, and he says, I've told you these things so that your joy may be complete, so that you would be even overflowing. John verse 15, 11 in the NIV reads like this. It says, I've told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. Jesus seems to be describing something exactly like that, complete joy. Complete joy, a joy that even overflows. So, I mean, reading this, we could say, well, is it even possible then to lose some of this joy, for this joy to run out? We know that there are other verses in the Bible, as we would find, for example, in the book of Isaiah, that speak of everlasting joy. So the question is, can we actually lose this joy? Can there be a sense of the tank going down? Well, the answer is that there are other Bible verses that do point to a sense of joy being lost, or certainly to a need for joy to be topped up and to be filled. Okay, so this is the one we looked at last Sunday, and as I recall, the week before as well. Psalm 51, verse 12 says, restore to me the joy of your salvation. After David's sin with Bathsheba and having her husband killed, he had the sense of a loss of joy, okay? There was a sense of a need for it to be restored. And there are other scriptures that speak to us of a need for joy to be filled sometimes, to be sort of supplemented, topped up. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 3 to 4. Paul writes this. He says, I thank God, whom I serve, as my ancestors did, with a clear conscience, as night and day I constantly remember you in my prayers. Recalling your tears, I long to see you, so that I may be filled with joy. Who's Paul writing it? He's writing and addressing Timothy, who was like a spiritual son. And he says, I long to see you. I want to see you. Why? So that my joy may be filled. I can be filled with joy. Now, if you read through to the end of this letter, you see Paul describing a very vulnerable place that he found himself in. Almost everyone had either deserted Paul or been sent away. The only one who was left with him was Luke. And so there's a real sense here, Paul, just so vulnerably just expressing his need to see Timothy so that it could be a sense of joy rising, in being filled with joy, all right? Similarly, in 2 John verse 12, we read this. I have much to write to you, but I do not want to use paper and ink. Instead, I hope to visit you and talk with you face to face so that our joy may be complete, all right? So what John's saying is there is a place, by the way, for writing letters. Just like in our day, there's a place for emails and for text messages. But yeah, he says, I want to come and see you face to face. Why? So that our joy may be complete, all right? So let's put it like this, okay? God's joy is an everlasting joy. There's no problem on God's side of things. That's never the case. But certainly from our side, there are things that we can go through, experiences, etc., that can have a sense of joy being depleted, or certainly a need for joy to be topped up and our joy to be filled, okay? So let's have a look at some of these so-called joy leaks. What are things that could almost knock some holes, punch some holes in the joy tank and cause a sense of joy to be draining away? Okay, let's have a look at a few of them. First, we'll come up with the category of loneliness. Okay, I'll put that heading up, of loneliness. This is a big one. There are a number of things that can slot under this very broad heading. Now, I want to say to you that I personally consider this to be potentially the biggest problem of all, this problem of loneliness. Okay, because remember, we've been defining joy relationally. We said that first and foremost, our joy is found in God, in relationship with Him, and then also in relationship with others. So you can see the obvious problem. If we are withdrawn, if there's a sense of distance and separation, but from God and from others, obviously it's going to affect and impact the joy that we're experiencing in our lives. Okay? You'll remember this verse from last Sunday, Psalm 16, verse 11. Said, you make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. There is fullness of joy in the presence of God. And as we said to you, you can also interpret that as there is fullness of joy in the countenance, the face of God. All right, now, herein lies the problem. if I'm hardly ever spending time with God, in the sense that it's almost like I'm never turning my face to the Lord, I'm never spending face-to-face time with Him, obviously that is going to impact the joy that I'm experiencing in my life. So perhaps, I was thinking about this, perhaps we shouldn't call this a joy leak as such. Perhaps this is more like never taking your car to the petrol station to be filled. Okay, so in more spiritual terms, it's us never drawing near to God, never turning our face towards Him and coming to the true fountain, the true wellspring of joy in our lives, and hence being refreshed and filled with joy, His joy, ourselves. So that makes sense. I hope that it does. That's our relationship with God. But what about human relationships? In recent times, we've come to discover that loneliness is a bigger health problem among others than we realized. So where you are lonely, you are more at risk for various mental and physical conditions, okay? And it's going to affect your joy too. Remember what we read earlier in 2 John verse 12, where John said that rather than writing a letter, he wanted to meet with them face to face so that their joy could be filled. Now, if our brains are searching, they're scanning, they're looking for joy in the eyes and the facial expressions of others, if those are absent, if we're not connecting with others, we can see the obvious problem where our brains are going to be, again, searching for something that isn't there for us, okay? So Wild and Hendricks, they specifically identify all of the screens in our lives. You're looking at one right now, okay? All of these screens as potential joy leaks. So yes, it's things like the TV, computers, and of course, all of the gadgets, the phones, etc., in our lives. Listen to what they say. Joy and screen time are inversely proportional. When our eyes and face are staring at our phones, we are not engaging with the faces around us. The joy drains out of our communities by depriving ourselves of each other's faces. Our need for face-to-face time is designed into our flesh and cannot be substituted with a screen. Our brains can distinguish between a real face and a face on a screen even when we are infants. Our neurological circuits do not react to screens the same way as they do to live faces. Since we need facial joy, like we need food and oxygen, we are starving ourselves of relational nutrition. How amazing is that? Isn't that incredible? When we say that God has created us for relationship, first for relationship with Him, and then for relationship with others, we're not joking. I mean, it really is. This is what science even proves, just how we are created as relational beings, created for relationships. And so we don't do well when we're on our own, when we are starved of these relationships. Now, let's be honest, things like Skype and Zoom, if you're trying to connect with people on a screen, even as we're doing right now, it's better than nothing. It really, really is. But it can never quite take the place of face-to-face time, of actually being present with something. We can't even fool our brains in this way. Isn't that quite incredible? So friends, you can spot now a major problem, yet another major problem that this COVID-19 pandemic has brought upon us, and that is self-isolation. During the lockdown, we were all forced indoors, into homes. We had to withdraw, okay? We had to be in a place where we couldn't gather with others, couldn't gather in church, we couldn't visit people, could only go to the shops or to the doctor under very restrictive kind of conditions. As I've said, I've never enjoyed going to the shops as much as I did during the hard lockdown. There was a chance just to be around other people, to see other people's faces, maybe to run into someone I knew and actually have a chance for a quick little conversation with them along the way, all right? This is the thing. You can see the obvious problem that self-isolation brings upon us through this pandemic, where we have had to withdraw. And the reason why so many people, Christians included, have experienced low joy during this pandemic, during this time, because of this withdrawal, the sense of isolation and disconnectedness from those who are around us. Okay, now we've tried to get as innovative as we can. We've gone online, telephone calls, lots of video stuff, and again, it's better than nothing. Again, we've done the best by the grace of God that we can in the circumstances, but it can never replace that sense of being physically present together and having that face-to-face time. All right, so we're going to talk about some of the fixes next time. We'll talk a little bit more about it. But can I just say to you that number one to prioritize is face-to-face time with God. Again, that picture of us turning our faces to God, drawing near to Him, being in the presence of the Lord, His face shining over us, and being filled with His joy. My friends, quiet times are not some little chore, some little duty that we've got to get out of the way. These are vital, life-giving times, times of refreshing, times where our joy can certainly rise and where we can be filled with the joy of the Lord. And then, of course, we have to prioritize being together, face-to-face with each other. Now, I realize as I'm sharing this message today, there will be some of you who are watching who have had to continue self-isolating through this pandemic because you have various comorbidities that put you at greater risk. So you haven't been able, for example, to come back to our live services. We fully understand, and please, nothing that I'm saying must put any kind of guilt trip on you. We look so forward to the day when this thing is behind us and when you can safely come back and join us. We look forward to that. Really, we do. But I would still encourage you, even in this time where you need to self-isolate, that you are being careful not to become disconnected from those around. So it might be things of more text messages, more phone calls, more video calls. Yes, it's not quite the same as being physically present, face to face, but again, it's better than nothing. So please ask the Lord for wisdom, walk it through with them, but just let's all be careful that we don't become self-isolated, we don't get into that place of loneliness, because it probably is one of the biggest, I think it's the biggest problem of all when it comes to joy running low in our lives. Does that make sense? I hope that it does. All right, let's move on. Here's another one, exhaustion or more going out than coming in. So the other picture would be, not that I never go to the petrol station, but I don't go often enough. All right, so let's give you an example. It could be that in my life, I'm really serving the Lord. There's a lot going out. That's not the problem. The problem is when it's not coming in. Okay, I'm not being filled up and refreshed and topped up in that way. So often, friends, we find ourselves living life in the red line. Okay, we high revs. We're going for it flat out. We're not resting as we should. We're not getting the sleep that we should. We're not getting the nutrition that we should. And we set ourselves up then too. We're at risk for our joy, taking a bit of a nosedive. There's an incredible account in 1 Kings chapter 18. It's the showdown on Mount Carmel between Elijah, the true prophet of God, and the 450 prophets of Baal. Most of you will know the story. Go and read it if you don't. It's an incredible, incredible story. Of course, it's God's battle. It's God's victory. But Elijah played such an incredible part in it. Just a man of great faith and saw incredible things. And then straight after that, he prays 7 times to end a 3-year drought as the Lord had directed. It's an incredible story. Really, you kind of think after that, Elijah must have been walking on air after what he saw and experienced, what he witnessed as the Lord worked so powerfully. But the very next chapter, friends, the very next chapter we read in 1 Kings 19 of Ahab, the king, going back, telling Jezebel, his wife, what happened. She then threatens to kill Elijah, and this great man of faith panics. He's afraid, and he goes on the run. He runs into the wilderness, and he basically prays to God and says, end it. Take my life. I've had enough. And you're thinking, wait, what the heck? I mean, you're up here on the mountain, and it feels like a moment later you are in the lowest, deepest valley. How do you go from there to there so quickly? Friends, we've got to recognize that with Elijah, it could be a combination of factors. Probably what he witnessed, as incredible as it was on Mount Carmel, probably did draw quite a lot from him. So there was a lot going out, okay? And perhaps he was in a place of exhaustion. He was in a place where he certainly hadn't eaten as he should. He hadn't rested as he should. And so he finds himself in this vulnerable place. But there's a point that Beth Moore makes that I think is an outstanding point on this. She says this: rarely are you more at risk for losing your joy than when you have just experienced a spiritual high, okay? It's the weirdest thing. It seems to make no sense. And yet this is 100% right. I've experienced this in my life. I experienced it after a number of young adults camps we used to run over the Easter weekend in my previous church. But the first time I ever experienced this and was quite shocked by it was after a home group a weekend away. I was leading a young adults home group in my previous church. And we went away together to the Midlands to a farm. And we had an amazing time. Great time of connecting, getting to know each other better, and great times in the presence of God. It was a great success. We came home. I dropped off someone I'd been giving lifts to, last person I dropped off. And as I was going home, I suddenly hit the slump. I knew I was tired, and it had been a busy weekend, okay? I knew I was tired, but it was more than that. It was like a feeling of depression. I didn't ever battle with depression, but I almost felt depressed. And it made no sense to me because we'd been on this high, and suddenly, bang, I'd hit this valley, and I couldn't understand what was going on. Friends, this is the thing. Now, of course, it's not as much of a problem because I'm more aware of the potential for a crash like that after a spiritual high. But the thing is this, friends, as wonderful as these times on the mountaintops are with God, we do need to be aware of the potential for a crash afterwards, okay? And can I just say two things about this? Number one, we can't go through our Christian lives trying to live from one mountaintop experience to the next, okay? That's an obvious one. The second thing is this, is that one of the best ways to keep your joy, to keep the joy that you had on that mountaintop, is as soon as possible afterwards, as soon as possible afterwards, come into the presence of the Father, okay? The one thing Elijah got right is he ran to God. And of course, the story ends with him coming into the presence of the Lord, that still small whisper of the Lord. And that's what we need, friends. The way to maintain that joy is to draw near to God as quickly as you can and to keep on being filled in his presence. All right, trust that helps. Next one, sin. Now, this is an obvious one. Sin has the potential to punch holes in our joy tank. So the once again, we remember the words of David, Psalm 51, verse 12, restore to me the joy of your salvation. With what David had done, it's little wonder that he had a sense of joy dropping, this joy of the Lord's salvation dropping in his life. Now, sin brings so much harm to us. It causes so much damage, so many problems. But one of the challenges is this, is that when we sin as Christians, we tend to know we're doing the wrong thing, okay? And especially when you get caught up in a cycle of sin, what happens is that guilt and shame begin to grow. Now, what did Adam and Eve do after they'd sinned? They ran away in the garden. They tried to hide from God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And friends, we tend to do the same thing. As our guilt and shame grows, we feel the need to hide our face from the face of God. So here's the thing, okay? Obviously, earlier we looked at John 15, where Jesus said to remain in him, to remain in his love, and this is where obedience becomes important. We need to obey Jesus. But in times where we do disobey, in times where we do mess up, friends, we have got to be so quick to turn to God, to confess the sin that we've committed, and again, to have that sense of that restoration of forgiveness, the forgiveness that is already ours in Jesus Christ, to receive that and know that to be true. I shared this one last Sunday, and I love this verse in that prayer of repentance. Verse 9 of Psalm 51 says, hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. Friends, when I turn to God in humility, when I repent, I turn away from what I've been doing and I confess my sin to him. The beautiful thing is God doesn't hide his face from me. He hides his face from those sins. The blood of Jesus blots out those iniquities. So let's be quick. When we do sin, when we do mess up, let's be quick to turn to God, to confess it, and to have that face-to-face, not to hide our faces from God, okay? Trust that helps. Last one, it's a big heading, big emotions and unresolved traumas. Now, this is a massive one. I feel like we're just gonna skim over this, okay? But I do wanna just cover it with you to make you aware of it. So remember that joy doesn't depend on our circumstances, all right? We can experience joy in the most challenging circumstances of life, but the authors, Wilde and Hendricks, do speak of a potential joy leak as being a lack of development in our lives around these six big emotions, and they are sadness, anger, fear, shame, disgust, and despair. We are going to experience these six emotions in our lives. It's going to happen, all right? The problem, friends, and if I had to try and explain it as simply as I can, it would be like this. Remember what we said, that you can experience joy and anger at the same time. You can experience joy and sadness at the same time. What happens is that joy helps you to regulate those emotions, okay? When we are in a place where we don't know how to do that, when there's this lack of development, we find ourselves getting caught in those emotions. We find ourselves behaving in a way that is not Christ-like and can cause us to lose connectedness with those around us. So they speak of the need for our brains to develop pathways from joy to these big emotions so that we can regulate, so that we can move on from these things and we don't get caught up in them. Okay, it's a big topic and there's more that could be said on that. I need to move on. How about this situation? Have you ever had a situation where you completely overreacted? Okay, and afterwards you thought back on it, you were very embarrassed and you thought, what the heck? Why did I behave like that? Why did I overreact like I did in that situation? Now, friends, that overreaction could point to an unresolved trauma in your life, okay? Something in the past that was never properly healed. You see, we think we've forgotten about it. We think we move on, but our right brain remembers, okay? And then you find yourself in a situation which is unpleasant, but that situation triggers that unresolved trauma, okay? It's almost, I always have the picture of still the wound still open. It's like someone sticking their finger in the wound and just aggravating it. Okay, so in that situation, you just snap, you lose it because that unresolved trauma, all that pain is then triggered and you overreact, All right. Now, the thing is this. We need to be aware of these things, and these kind of traumas need to be addressed with the help of someone who knows how to address them. These are big things. Don't ignore them, okay? You'll discover when they're there, because they definitely, like these, some of these other emotions, when we don't process them and regulate them properly, they definitely can cause joy leaks in our life. All right, there's more that could be said, but I need to stop there for today. So here's the thing. Friends, in eternity with God, new heaven, new earth, everlasting joy. In the presence of the Lord on that day, nothing will cause you to lose joy. Nothing. You won't lose even a little milliliter of the joy of the Lord, okay? The joy tank will be full and overflowing forever and ever. Challenge is, we're not there yet. We're still in this world with many troubles, many circumstances that can affect us and can try to challenge the joy of the Lord in us. So again, today, I want to encourage you, and we're going to have a time now as we close with a song where we're not looking for things that aren't there, but I want to encourage you just to search your own heart with the Lord and just ask yourself the question, have I been chasing after pseudo joys in my life? Have I been seeking other pleasures to try to substitute and replace a lack of the joy of the Lord in my life? And if you have, can I ask you today just to say, Lord, I'm sorry. Today I seek you. I seek the joy that is found in you alone. Because my friends, it's a futile chase. We'll never satisfy that lack of joy, of the Lord's joy, with any other pleasure in this world. Okay? That's the first thing. The other thing is to then be aware of these joy leaks. Are there things in your life right now, and I won't run through the whole list again, but are there things that are threatening to drain away joy? That's the one thing. Or maybe even there's a sense that actually I need to top up joy as well. Okay? We're going to take some time as we worship this song. Let's just keep our hearts open to the Lord. Let him speak to us. Let him lead us, even as we sing the song, Better Is One Day in Your Courts. What a great song. What an appropriate song to be able to land on as we draw near to him, as we fix our gaze on him and receive from him and be filled by the Lord. Can we do that together? Let's worship him and then we'll close.